Hey guys, Miss Marissa here, and in this video we're going to continue to talk about solving differential rate law problems using experimental data. And we're going to do so by looking at two additional examples. So in our first example here, we have an overall reaction that's occurring. They've run this reaction three different times with different combinations of molarities of our different reactants, and they've measured an initial rate of each of those trials. And so what we want to do is we want to solve what the orders are for both of these reactants, as well as determine what the rate law constant K would be. And so what I'm going to do first is actually write a formula for my rate law expression. So as we remember from our previous video, rate is always equal to K, our first reactant of Br2 raised to some exponent, which for right now I'm going to put X there, and our C3H6O, also raised to some exponent. This time though, we're gonna put Y since its order will be different than Br2's. And so again, what we wanna do is solve for K, X, and Y by plugging in this data here for rate and our two concentrations. And so in order to solve the respect to one of these reactants, I'm gonna need to pick two trials where some of my unknown variables remain consistent. So that way, when I set a ratio of one trial over another, at least some of the variables will cancel out. And so if I wanna solve the order with respect to Br2, what that means is that I wanna solve X. And so in order to solve X, I would not only want K to cancel out, which it will automatically, but I would also want Y to cancel out. And so therefore, I need to pick two trials where the C3H6O stays the same. And what we would do is once we have those two trials selected, we would put one trial over the other one to help us start solving that order. For the order with respect to C3H6O, I would want to solve Y. And so to solve Y, we would want to pick two trials where Br2 stays the same. And so that way, the X could cancel out and I wouldn't have to worry about that as far as my math is concerned. As a reminder, when you pick your two trials and you set up your ratios, we would always want to put the trial with the bigger numbers on the top and the smaller numbers on the bottom, as the numbers end up being a little more easy to see. So what I want you to do is to go ahead and pause this video, go ahead and see if you can solve X and Y, and then go ahead and see if you can solve X down below. So go ahead, pause the video and try out this example. All right, did you pause it? Did you try it out? I hope you did. We're going to go ahead and check it. So to solve the order with respect to Br2, I went ahead and selected trial 2 and trial 1. I put trial 2's information on top of trial 1's because trial 2 had some bigger numbers involved with it. And so then when I set that up, what happened is that K ended up canceling. The 0.1 raised to the Y ended up canceling out. And as a reminder, that means you would not have had to show those in your setup. I usually do because I like to see those canceling out. But I would then solve this math right here, which got a value really, really close to 1. I know it's not exactly perfect, but remember, this is experimental data. And so experimental data is not always on the nose perfect. 0.2 over 0.1 would give me 2, and that would be raised to an order of X. And so then I want to figure out what X would be. As a reminder, X, those orders are always going to be either 0, 1, 2, 3, or 4 when you're doing these types of problems. Here, because a number raised to the exponent ended up equaling 1, what that means is that my order was actually 0. This was 0 order with respect to Br2. And you're like, whoa, that's kind of weird. What does that mean? Well, if you look at this for a second, you notice there was pretty much no change in the rate, even though I doubled the concentration of Br2 here. So what that means is that even though Br2 is important to this reaction, stoichiometrically, I need Br2 in order to produce my product, I don't actually change the rate of this when I change the concentration of Br2. Changing the concentration of Br2 doesn't make the reaction go any faster or slower than it did previously. What that probably means on our mechanism is that Br2 was not involved in the slow step. And so that's why we see it as an order of zero, because it doesn't affect the overall rate of this reaction. Now, C3H6O, on the other hand, when I solve it, I did trial 3 over trial 1. When I solved this math right here, that got a value of 2. K and the 0.1 to the 0 both canceled out here. And so 0.2 over 0.1 is 2, and that would be raised to the order of y. And so therefore here, y equaled 1. So this was first order with respect to the C3H6O. So now when I write my rate law expression, that thing with the zero order doesn't have to be included in your overall rate law expression. So you notice the only thing I put in here was the C3H6O. I did not put the Br2 at all. If you did try and put it, you want to make sure you show it has an exponent of 0 or it would be counted off. Remember, not putting an exponent actually means it's an understood exponent of 1. So be really careful on that. So that means my overall order actually just ends up being 1. There's not another order that I would need to add to this order of 1 in order to get to that overall order. So now, the value for the rate law constant K with units. In the dark orange here, I have plugged in everything to my rate law expression. So I didn't rearrange this before I solved. So what I did then is I said, hey, I want to get K by itself. So that means I need to bring this 0.01 over to the other side. So when I divided that over here, what that ended up doing is getting me a value of 1.64 times 10 to the negative 4th. The two molarities ended up canceling out, and so that gave me a unit of just divided by seconds. You could have also reported seconds to the negative first. The reason why the molarity is not involved is if you think about the formula for K that we talked about in the previous video, it would be molarity raised to the negative overall order minus 1. And so since the overall order is 1, 1 minus 1 just ends up being 0. And so that's why it doesn't get included. So then our temperature dependent rate law expression would simply be that rate equals 1.64 times 10 to the negative 4th. You could put per seconds or seconds to the negative 1st. And then our C3H6O raised to an order of 1, which I don't have to write because it's understood. All right, let's go ahead and look at the one on the next page. Now, this one is a little different because it involves pressures. Whenever I have gases in my reaction, we could either do these problems in terms of molarity, but we could also do them in terms of pressure. And there's a couple things that would change when pressure is involved. First off, we would not use brackets when molarity is not involved. So what you'll see here is when we write our expressions on this one, we're going to do so using parentheses. Also, because I'm using parentheses, that doesn't automatically indicate a unit like the brackets do for molarity. So you notice on here, instead of just writing NO or H2, they actually wrote it with its P included for pressure. So that way we can be really specific about which unit we're using. All right, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to first kind of think about this problem without necessarily writing down any math. Obviously, sometimes these problems could be in the multiple choice part of the AP test, and if it was, I would want to be able to do it without a calculator. And so what I can start to do is kind of see what the numbers are doing each time I'm making these changes. So for example here, let's say I wanted to pick the order with respect to NO. Well, to solve NO, I would need to pick two trials where H2 remains the same. I see that H2 remains the same on trial 3 and 4. So let's kind of see what the numbers are doing for the pressures and the rates on those two trials. To go from 150 to 300, to change that pressure, that would be multiplying by 2. I've doubled my pressure there. And when I've doubled my pressure, I notice here on the rates that those have basically quadrupled. So now think about that. If I double this pressure here, and that results in a quadrupling of the rate, what must be the exponent on that particular pressure? Well, if you think about it, 2 squared is 4, and so that means I'm going to guess that NO is probably second order. We're going to confirm that here in just a minute. But again, I wanted you to see how you could kind of think about this. The same thing goes for the H2. Now, to solve H2, I would want 2 trials where NO remains consistent. I see that's happening on trials 1 and 2. So again, I'm going to look and see what my numbers are doing. I went from 150 to 300 here, so that's doubling. But here, I noticed that the rate also doubled. So if the pressure is doubling, and then thereby the rate is doubling, that probably means that that pressure was only raised to an exponent of 1. And so therefore, I would predict that H2 is a first order substance. Now, could I do math and verify these numbers? Absolutely. But if I was doing this, say, on a multiple choice part of the AP test, I might want to be able to do this without writing all that math down. And so you can see if they gave you really clean numbers to work with like that, it makes that process a little bit easier. So let's go ahead and see if our math confirms that. Now, I did something a little extra on here. First off, I showed you how I would have justified this using some math setup. This is the bare minimum of work that you would need to show. So again, I did not show how K and the other reactant canceled. So that's okay as long as you kind of address everything else in this math. And so that proved that it was indeed second order with respect to NO. However, let's say you did not want to show math on that FRQ question, that you would rather justify it using words. That is acceptable. Here's what you would need to write for that. It says, when the pressure of H2 is held constant and the pressure of NO is double, the rate quadrupled, indicating a second order for NO. You notice they mentioned what stayed constant, what the change was in the other reactant, what that did to the rate, and therefore what is the order. So all of those things would need to be addressed if you're choosing to do this with words instead of math. I'll be honest, most people, including myself, choose to justify this with math because honestly, I think it's a little bit faster to show that math than to write all those words out. That's just me, but you are allowed to justify these with words as well. Same thing goes on the other one. You can see my math here did confirm that it was first order with respect to H2. And so again, you could justify this with words. When the pressure of NO is held constant and the pressure of H2 is doubled, the rate doubled, indicating a first order for H2. Okay, so now let's talk about our temperature independent rate law expression. You notice that I'm not able to use brackets here. Again, I'm not dealing with molarity, and so it's really important to show that when we're doing our expression. So what I did is I used parentheses around my 2 pressures. Also remember, because I don't have the brackets specifically telling me, hey, I'm using molarity, the only way to indicate what unit is being used here is by specifying here that these are pressure values. So I didn't just write NO and H2 in these. I actually wrote it with that pressure variable included. Now, technically, you don't have to show anything around these substances. You could just put the pressure variables like so. The brackets are important because they indicate molarity. But here, if you're putting the P, then you're indicating what variable is being used. Since the 2 and the 1 add up to give us 3, that would be my overall order. So now when I'm doing the value of K, I would approach this just like I do normally. So again, kind of thinking about it before rearrangement, that would be plugging in this rate equals K, 400 millimeters mercury squared, 150 millimeters of mercury raised to the first. I did use trial one. Again, you could use any trial that you wanted to. It should get you about the same data. What I then did is brought these two over to the other side, so I would end up dividing by those two numbers. Again, being careful for order of operations when you're plugging this in your calculator. I typically divide by the first thing, 400 squared, and then divide by the 150. You could also put the entire denominator in parentheses. That got me a value of 2.75 times 10 to the negative 8th. But now here's where you got to be careful on your unit. If you're choosing it to do it this first way, that's fine, but you could also do it this second way with the negative exponents instead of dividing by your units. The unit of time, again, comes from your table up above. That was in terms of seconds, and so therefore I have seconds here. But notice that instead of molarity, I now have millimeters of mercury. And so be very careful on that unit when you're doing pressure, because it's going to be different than using molarity. So then again, my exponent is that overall order minus one. So 3 minus 1 would be 2. And so you can see on both formats that 2 being present. And so then my temperature dependent rate law expression would be rewriting that with my K plugged in. And again, I use those parentheses with the variable of P there. Last but not least down here, it says, hey, if the pressure of both substances were tripled, what effect would that have been on the rate? And so again, tripling the NO, NO is raised to an order of 2, so that would be 9 times faster. The pressure of the H2, if that's tripled, that's only raised to an order of 1, so that would only triple the rate. And so then I multiply those two effects together, which would get me that I would have a rate 27 times faster than the original rate that I had. All right, I hope we're feeling good about solving these differential rate law problems. If you have any questions or need any help, please feel free to email me. Bye, guys.